Queen Lozikeyi, we think, was born about 1855. In other words, when Ndebele had already settled in Matabeleland. Somewhere near or at Fort Usher. Fort Usher is close to the Bulawayo. It's along the old Gwanda Road. And that area where she was born was part of the village called Ingama, which originally was under Usomhlolo Engumathema. And she was born, perhaps before we proceed, perhaps we need to explain what's this Fort Usher. Fort Usher was the first native commission for that Matobo district. But a 14, when they are referring to Fort, say 14. So it was Usher, and I think we should know who Usher was. When whites had deserted King Lopengula, three whites remained. One of them was William Usher, and then there was James Dawson, and then there was also a James Fairbairn. So it was named after him, and he must have married, I think, Ndebele woman, Uma Khumalo. So she was born 1855, and the father is Ngogo. We need to explain. We are back to a cultural father and a biological father. The father is Ngogo. Ngogo, I think, is a coin. And that father, Ngogo, is said to be her father, but it's a cultural father, as I will explain. The biological father was a twin to Ngogo, and that twin was known as Chocha. So, and what happened? Two twins, chances are, I'm not sure, they may have been identical twins. So both of them married Omachabalala. So the elder, well, can say elder, one Machabalala, Oga Ngogo, Ngogo then dies. As per the Bele tradition, the younger brother, Uchocha, marries late brother's wife, or widow, but is also a Machabalala. Then the daughter out of that, kuthiwa ikungena ngesiNdebele, is the queen. That's how she is born. So she has two fathers, which will not make sense to people who are not familiar with our culture. But because the wife belonged to or was Ngogo's wife, if a brother comes and makes her pregnant, whoever is born by this Machabalala is Ngogo's child. That's why we say Ulozikeyi Ngoka Ngogo. But in reality, uzalwa Nguchocha. And this is why you see when we talk later about her now going to stay at Nkosikazi. She brings Umaja, who is his nephew, ezalwa nguChocha, bazohlala bonke khona ngale. And I think he's buried there, nguMaja lo. Right, we'll talk about that later. So she grows up there, Engameni, nguEngameni. Abakodlodlo, abeEngameni, we have some of them, like Omutuani, people like Nganani, Margaret, are descended from Yonaliana Isaidi, Egamtuwani. So there are many of them there. Muntuwani, very prominent, especially during the Mvukela period. But with Ulozikeyi bengabakodlodlo, her father, we've said, I think we've established that, and grandfather may have been Undingindi. Undingindi was the son of Longovu. Ulongovu, son of Sidinani. Usidinani, the son of Mpangazitha. Mpangazitha, the son of Pungani. That would be the lineage, the little I know of those. These were the Dlodlos. Remember, before they were assimilated into Ndebele society, they were not Dlodlo. They become Dlodlo only after assimilation into Ndebele society. But they had an important state of their own as the Dlodlos, Amahlubi, Amangelengele, these are Mtimkulu people, Ohatebe, Umashwabata, Oashwabatela, Inkomo, Nempondo Zayo. Those are the people. But then comes the Mfecane period, and there's the scattering. They are disturbed or scattered by the leader of the Ngwane people, and that was Mantiwane, Engwakohlongwane. He's the first man really who sets these Amahlubi moving, and then they move. Some of them end up at the Cape, Eastern Cape, where they are even today, as people seeking refuge. Others run away, and later, under the leadership of Mpangazitha, some of them will get to Lesotho. They are there and referred to or known as Pagalita. That's Mpangazitha in Sotho, a Sotho rendition of that Mpangazitha. And Mpangazitha ultimately is killed by Umatiwane. Then son Mehlo Makhulu then leads the people to the Ndebele. The Ndebele at that time, we had left about 1820, 1821, were staying in the middle fall Ulikwa River after their initial northward advance until they came into contact with this Msene clan led by Ungaba Ngaba, and they were and also met Abapedi, and then they turned upwards along the Stillput River and until they got to Ndubazi, where they found the so-called Transvaal Ndebele, Amanzuza, Lamanala, and the Ndebele incorporated Omahlangu, Omapena, Osibindo, Mkuchini, Mkwananzu, Kau, Makwentava, Omasugu, Penyani, not Ungamagazi. And then they moved down towards the Middle Fall. It was at that place, either 1822 or 1823, when the Dlodlos now, under Mehlo Makhulu, come and join. They had become stateless. There was no state for them. So they joined, and they were placed on the southern bank of the Fall River under Chief Usokogozela, and then they had their village there. Note that it was the first time that Mzilikazi was coming into contact with the Dlodlos. He had married one of his first wives before he became king. One of them was Emma Dlodlo, the mother of Mangwana. There was also Emafuyane, the mother of Lopila. There was Umasugu, Unakaqalingana. There was also Umaskola, I think the mother of Uchugisa, also known as Umuntu. So they had been, we shouldn't imagine that these Dlodlos were at one place, even where Mzilikazi was born in that area. They were there. So they joined that one. But as we know, Mehlo Makhulu then decides, Lapa, you can't have two bulls in the same spire. This Mzilikazi will get jealous. Wase Baliega. But it is about from that time that they are referred to as Dlodlo. Labo sebefaka izidlodlo. And they are accepting overlordship. Mzilikazi, labana baka Mehlo Makhulu, babaliga. But about six Dlodlo men remain and become assimilated into Ndebele society, and very soon they are elevated, and many of them, such as Linganisa, such as Loiswayo, become izinduna, especially as a Makandeni, Ensingweni, Inqa Zonke, also referred to as Inqa at other times. So those are the Dlodlos. I think that should suffice by way of background. Njengabantu who came now under Khondwane together with Amnyama, which incorporated Umzinyathi, Amatshetshe, Intshamathe, Uyengo, Integelo, Intunta, and others. That's part of Amyama, Ababuya, La Makosigas, Mwaga, and Fulata. And then the Jojos, Amakanda, including Indinana, Egamfanilele, Umachazi, then Umakuchwa, Inzwananzi, and others. All those constituted what we refer to as Amakanda. So there she is born, 1855. I think we have given her the background. But we then, she becomes prominent in that she was endowed with perhaps a unique spirituality. Ulozikeyi ibi inyanga. Ube lakho kwakibo abakho dlodlo. Generally, the dlodlos were very strong in spirituality, in matters of spirituality. So when King Lobengula now already has married quite a number, it's important to explain why she becomes queen. King Lobengula, before marriage, before accession, before he became king, there was already a number of wives. One whose isibongo I do not know, but mother to Mangisimane. Then there was Umpita Okalotata Mkhwananzi, the mother of Unyamande and Sintinga Ntinga Senkosi Uchakalisa. Then there was also another daughter of the same man, Ulotata Okumkhwananzi. That was Mfazi Wamajaha. And is the mother of Umhlambi Useka Dabengwa. Not Dumiso, no. Dabengwa, who also, his grave is together with that of Queen Lozikeyi, with that of Umaja. We're going to mention Umaja. I think we've already mentioned Umaja. Uti Umtaka Chocha, the brother to Ungoko. So those are the women who are already married. Then Lozikeyi comes. Not as a queen. It's important to point that one. She does not go there as a queen. She's actually going there as a medical doctor, inyanga. But there had been efforts to conceal ukuthi ulanda ubunyanga kolobhengula. But that's exactly what he was going there for. The senior queen had to be found from elsewhere. And that queen is Xhwalile Nxumalo once again. And the daughter of Mzila, the chief of the Shangani across the Save River. So she was going to conceive or bear the heir apparent. And so about 1879, Uloche Uhlabangana, Mtenge Hashi, the chief of Induba, together with Xukuthwayo Umlotshwa, who was chief of Intemba, they were dispatched to go and find the senior queen for King Lobengula. And indeed, a woman had been assigned, a daughter had been assigned, Dombole. They discovered, no, same Dala Kakhulu. Then they opted for a younger one, and that was Xhwalile Nxumalo. And she was brought here to the king, delivered to the king, and she stayed at Mkanwini. But unfortunately, she did not conceive. Will not follow that story. It's not very relevant too. So effectively, therefore, it meant Lozikeyi Umadlodlo had now become the senior queen. But she has gone there as inyanga. But the populace has been given an impression that she is a wife. But if she was going there as inyanga, there were no sexual relationships with Lobengula, and how would you have expected to conceive? And indeed, she didn't. But again, to continue with the narrative that she was a queen, a wife, the Dlodlos brought Inhlanzi for her, a surrogate wife, Nyesikiwa, to conceive on her behalf. And that was the daughter of Umleche. Umleche was a brother to both Ngoko and Chocha. And the name of that Inhlanzi Mamfimfi's daughter was Sorry, the daughter is Manfi Mfi. It's Mleche's daughter. Who is come ukuzezalela uLozikeyi. She is Manfi Mfi. And indeed, after gynecological interventions by a Ncube inyanga called Sidambe, Chidambe abesezala. And the daughter, as you know, according to Ndebele tradition, where a child was born after gynecological intervention by a man has to be named after that traditional doctor. Hence, Lobengula's daughter with Manfi Mfi Umadlodlo was Sidambe, Queen Sidambe, who got married to Siacha Fuyame, and their daughter was Pombo. Pombo's son is alive and is Makakula. Makakula, Anthony Ntisi Makakula at Masunga Mala, just beyond Lupanda, across the Kwai River. That's where he is. I visited him several times. He is one very good source of the history of Queen Lozikeyi and royalty. He's still alive, very old now. I think he's over 90 years now. So the queen remains there. No son, as we expect. But there is. So what it meant effectively is queen, the heir hasn't been born by the right queen. Twalile. Ngapa, lo, nothing. So it meant now an ordinary woman, ordinary queen, born after Lobengula was king, would qualify. And this is how Impoliana is the Ndebele word for Ingupa Mazwi. And her father was Umabuyane. Mabuyane himself was a son of Kondwane Ndiwene, who was King Mzilikazi's maternal uncle. Abalala sisusinye with Cikwose Ndiwene. So that's the story. So Lozikeyi then is there, and she's staying at this at Bulawayo as the senior queen now. That's what is important about her. She is the senior queen. But then there comes a time now when the Ndebele state is destroyed. And the queens, the senior queen amongst them, follow the queen, the king who has fled north. They go as far as beyond the Shangani River, you know, Pupu. They went beyond that. But word comes, go no further, queens, the son has said. Langa said ichonil. Which was a convincing way of telling them to go back. It was unlikely they were going to go back when they knew their husband was still on the move. But the son has said. But as we know the story, it was all a decoy. Somebody had been killed. Makwekwe Fuyani had been killed to take the place of King Lobengula, buried at Pashu Cave, and then Mhlangamen Ngomba, I think was his name, then is also buried there. And then a lot of diamonds also deposited there. A lot of royal material is deposited there to convince would-be pursuers that the king lay there dead. That's his burial place. But meanwhile, he has proceeded and crossed the Zambezi River and sought refuge among relatives. And his relatives were Nguni people. And these were people of Mpezeni, who was the son of Zwangendaba, who had left at the time when Mzilikazi was also living, and they settled at Chipata. We visited that place with Reverend Tamasani sometime, and they took us to somewhere very near a mountain which they pointed to us. There lies your king Lobengula. The grave is there. The place is called Nsanjiga. That's the place where his remains were interred. And I remember Hlabangana Nsele used to tell me, because he was connected with royalty, I think I need to point out that the people who were what you may term abangaphakathi possess more historical information than other people. So Nsele Hlabangana, Hlabangana sister uhobile was married to Tabengwa umtaka Mhlambi, and so Mhlambi's father was was married to Tabengwa. Tabengwa being the son of Mhlambi, so that's royal. So he got to know this history and said to me, when I interviewed him at Vanna's house in Montrose many years ago now, he said there was link between Lobengula out there and his descendants here. Tabengwa himself used to go there. And that's what led to their marriage being strained. And then Chakalisa used to go there. Hence he named his sons Tabulamanzi and another one was Edilizwe. Tabulamanzi was the elder, went to Inyati but absconded, and then in his place Chakalisa came in and was a student at Inyati. Edilizwe traveling way to see the father. Tabulamanzi crossing the river Zambezi, esiyangapi to see the father. So it was there. But the Ndebele then, unlike our Ndebele today, were very secretive. They could keep secrets. Babengelazo izifube ezakhatshwa ngamaduku. So they come back. So Lozikeyi and other queens, remember, not just Lozikeyi, there were many of them. So the Omamfimfi and others would have been there, Omoho, Tebe, and men, Omaduma, would have been there. So they come back. Initially, they settle here at Bulawayo. But Bulawayo has been burnt. It's a ruin. And then later on, a place is found for them. That area where one Mfulana Khumalo. Mfulana Khumalo, when Mzilikazi traveled back, remember he had taken that western route. Uchani bude busemahalihali kabuchi na kucha boti nyakana kuchayo byokuchane micha amadoda. So he was out there makhalihali salt pan. Finally he comes up the Kwai River and then turns east to follow the Mbembezi River until he gets to Mfazimiti, those Mawala hills just outside Bulawayo. So they had left a man in the Sikanda area. That Ndebele man who kept his nkomo zamambowe was Mfulana Khumalo. So when a place, it was him who advised about where Queen Lozikeyi was to settle. He knew that area, Sikanda area. He knew and advised him, hey, because he had large head of cattle, to settle near Mbembezi where her cattle would be watered. And that's what happened. So that Nkosikazi area, which is named after Unkosikazi, then that's where they settled. And she's settling with other queens. But other queens choose to get married. We know people like Mchana Khumalo married some of them. But Queen Lozikeyi, Lol, never got married. Why would she get married when she had never been married? But on it was a pretended marriage. So she always wore, when you look at her pictures, you will see her wearing isincwazi, this band that they wear on their heads. It says a sign that somebody is a widow. So she had, in her case, become a career widow, if we might call it that, permanent widow. Whereas, and let's differentiate that isincwazi from umncwazi, those people who were part of umtimba accompanying umakoti, they wore imincwazi emncwazini, south of Emgwanwini. There is a place called Emncwazini or Esamatonga, Isigaba Samatonga, where umtotobi mlilo was the chief. So she decided no marriage for her, and then instead would look after the royal progeny. the princes and also the queens before some of them started moving away, some to get married, others to go and live elsewhere. But she stayed there till her death. She had a large head of cattle. And one thing that we need to mention, with the once she had settled at Nkosigazi, she had quite a number of abesihlangu, these are captives. During the heyday of the Ndebele state, her brother, Umuntuwani, who belonged to Madla Amadlampondo, under the command of a Giani, chief Owago Giani, they used to raid Ebutonga. And that Muntuwani brought a number of captives, Abesihlangu, and gave them to his sister, Umadlolo, Queen Lozikeyi. One was named Umadlampondo in honor of the regiment to which Umuntuwani had belonged. The other one was named Twalimbiza. Twalimbiza, for some of us, is a familiar name because his descendants are our friends. One was the late Victor George Ndlovu, who was the headmaster of Luveve High School, descended from Twalimbiza, and they were given the surname of Ndlovu. Then the other one is Method Ndlovu, a younger brother of VG Ndlovu. So, and then there was a lady, Tonga also, like the other two, Unkwe. So, Babe Lala. So, you need to appreciate that Lozikeyi had a large contingent of people who lived with her. And inkomo zazihlatshwa almost daily. Inyama iphekwa ngomhluzi wenye, as we would put it in our language. And if you look at one of her houses, you will see on top of the roof, impondo zenkomo. That was the practice among the Ndebele. If an animal had been killed for ritual purposes, ikhanda lezi, part of inhloko ikhanda lelana ukhakhayi with the horns is placed direct on the roof, directly above umnyango. And one of Queen Lozikeyi's houses is like that. So you see, and so there were many of them, and there were people who were coming. She was involved, we should have pointed that out, in the 1896 Impi Yehloke Libomvu. She was consulted, and we are told even during Imfazo 1 to us means the 1893 war, when the Ndebele resisted colonial penetration. Imfazo 2 to us refers to the 1896 war, where Queen Lozikeyi played a role. Not that she went to fight physically, but she was consulted. She would remember she was a spiritual individual. So she was consulted on that basis. And even during this Imfazo 3, which is the struggle now, the most recent struggle, starting perhaps in the 1960s, culminating in the Lancaster House Agreement of December 1979. So that's Imfazo 3. So she was consulted. She was consulted. So that's important role, therefore, in efforts to re-establish the Ndebele state, she was involved. Then we need to point out her role in trying to embrace Christianity, education. Her belief was, let's learn their ways so that one day we may challenge them. It was not seeking to learn their ways to become stupid, no, but to understand them. understand how their belief system works, then you can change a situation that you know. If you don't understand these people, you haven't got their education, you haven't got their religion, how do you hope to fight them? So she asked Reverend Bowen Rees, who was a Tinyati, from 1888 to 1918. And note that that year is very significant. So Reverend Bowen Rees, a Tinyati, and Queen Lozikeyi, at Nkosikazi. One lives in Nyati, 1918. Queen Lozikeyi dies, 1919. Just 1 year. So, and cameras were already there. One person who visited, among the visitors, who visited Queen Lozikeyi was one Johann Colin Brenda. Colin Brenda, there is a street named after him, I think in North End. And he's one man who soon after the defeat of the Ndebele was sent together with other men constituting a team to identify areas of settlement for the defeated Ndebele. And it was them who identified Shangani Reserve, which today is Nkai and Lupane, and then Kwai Reserve, which today is Cholocho in 1894. So he had a store very close to Gosivalo. That's where he was, this Colin Brenda, and lived there, operated a store. And one of the missionaries, LMS missionaries, I think it was W.G. Brown, Reverend W.G. Brown, found him there. W.G. Brown came after Rees. There were others, and then there was another one, William Elliot, also came after, I think, Rees, if not earlier. Anyway, what is important, therefore, is Reverend Bowen Rees also took photographs, like Colin Brenda. We have pictures of Lozikeyi with Colin Brenda, but more of Queen Lozikeyi with or by Reverend Bowen Rees, because he used to visit her at Nkosikazi. But what we then do see, it's not a part, Queen Lozikeyi wanting to embrace LMS religion and teachings, and he invites Umatambo Ndlovu. And so he had been at Shangani, this Umatambo Ndlovu had been at Shangani, where a number of outstations had been opened. Dagamela, another one at Sivalo, another one at Malinga, another one at Madliwa, another one at Skobokobo. Those were opened about 1914 by the Reverend Bowen Rees. So Matambo was withdrawn from one of those outstations of the LMS, Nyati outstations, and then went to live at the Queen's residence, and schools were opened there. There's a primary school nearby. So that was through the effort of Queen Lozikeyi. Then, I think as we end, there was this disease connected to the First World War, which broke out in 1914 and ended 1919. Then it brought what we call ngesiNdebele ifuleza. It was actually influenza, Spanish flu, I think. And my own grandfather, my father's father, died in 1919 from that, and where his village is scattered with a lot of graves. So if you go to Nkosikazi, where the queen is buried, you are going to find lots of graves of others who perished with her as a result of this influenza of 1919. That's when she died. And that ends the story. But there is her legacy that goes on. A school is named after her. It's Lozikeyi Primary School in Nguboyenja, that is a school named after her. I'm not aware that there is a township named after her. I'm not aware that there is a road named after her. But there is scope, and I would encourage those who are engaged in naming to also include her beyond the school. She probably deserves a township.
Her character, what kind of a person was she? You at times get to hear that she was a tough person, things like that. What kind of a person
was she? She was tough. This is why they will refer to her as Umfazi Wechayindoda. And she carried a shambok, by the way, and she smoked dag. So she was a strong character. Perhaps we can go back to her history. There's something that perhaps becomes relevant because you've asked that question. Mhlambi, for some reason or other, was meant to be killed on the instructions of her father, King Lobengula. So there was one Mampengesi who was tasked to accompany him to an unknown destination, but probably to kill him. But then Mhlambi along the way says, can you please go back and take my son and deliver her to my mother? Remember the mother, to his mother, but grandmother to Tabengwa. And that was Umfazi Wamajaha. And indeed, Mampengesi does that, but the queen refuses. Umfazi Wamajaha says, no. He suspected Lobengula might go for her. Why are you doing this? So, but Queen Lozikeyi says, yes, I shall take care of her. That's what brought Utabengwa to Lozikeyi. So, Amthathe, but pretends, ay, umntwana nje, who is a captive. Probably explaining why there's that name, which is a corrupted Kalanga name, Tabengwa. Tabengwa is a corrupted, it's a corruption by the Ndebele of a Kalanga name, Tabengwa, who have been hated or something like that. So she was therefore a person of strong character. And you could see here is an individual of strong leadership qualities, fearless. And you will see in one of the pictures the authority that she wielded. There was Sivalo. Sivalo Mahlangu was a son of Mveleleni, then named Usivalo because, trying to cut short a very long story. One, when the Ndebele arrived at Ndubazi, where there were those people, Mahlangu, Osibindi, Mkuchini, Skosana, and others, there was formed a regiment called Izimpangele. And they were there at Gibixeku when the king had taken the other route. Now, when the king approached, having been found and identified by Umkitika Tebe, Upokum Samans, then those decided to run away. Mveleleni had a wife, a Mabena wife, who was expecting. So the son was born. They said, Musivalo. Usezazala njani futhi, the husband has run away. With Izimpangele, that's Mvelele, went back. Ngabaka Makotonga, they had gone back. We don't know whether they reached their destination, Makotonga and Ndubazi, that I don't know. But the name, as I always say, this is how we document our history. People should never ever say we didn't document history. We didn't write history. Documenting is not about writing. All societies have ways of documenting. We had our own. Through our praise poetry, We were, it's a form of documenting, say, of chronicling our histories, our experiences in our names. That's very important. So Usivalo is the man who then came back with the queens. For a while, they stayed with him. And so later on, I Laabe Zakeli Muzwake across the Shangani. That's where he was. I went there when Solomon Mahlangu was the chief, and he took me on a tour, showed me the grave of the original Sivalo, who we have in our book there. So that was him. So she was Indotamfaz, we could say. See, because in the tradition, which reminds me again, there's something that I'd forgotten about. Ndebele tradition did not allow Ndebele woman to preside over a court. Tony Samacala, no. Even when she goes there to the court, Enkundleni, she would not be allowed to stand. She would be, kneeling. I've witnessed that. She would kneel. So when Lozikeyi was there, Nkosikazi, she realized, hey, Amacala azathoniswa ngubani. So Mfulana Khumalo, that man she found in the vicinity, in the locality, became the chief. But unfortunately, Mfulana Khumalo did not produce sons. All his children were daughters. NgesiNdebele kuthiwa ngamawabayi. So it meant finished. When that happens, according to Ndebele tradition, there is no, that family line stops. You can't continue, but you would need to go now to a younger brother. We are dinga, we continue indlule esicijile. So it had been suggested that one person be appointed who was also connected with the royalty. And that was Mlonyeni Khumalo. He becomes the chief. He is not chief during the time of Lobengula, but goes there to become chief endaweni kaNkosikazi uMadlodlo. And when he dies, he is succeeded by his son Usibuzo. But Sibuzo doesn't reign that much, and briefly, and a brother of his, a younger brother to Sibuzo, takes over. He is Mabigwa Khumalo. And Mabigwa, as the name sounds, it's not Ndebele. But again, it is a result of some gynecological intervention by a Kalanga doctor. And so Mabigwa, you have been cooked or something like that. So he gets that name. As per Ndebele tradition, name the son, the girl, after the doctor who helped this woman conceive. That's Mabigwa. There are many examples that I could give where non-Ndebele doctors were used. Stambo already we've talked about. And Majingila, Mkwananzi, Mazingire, Umlemba, again, who made it possible ukuthi kuzalwe when Liso's wife could not produce, bese kuzalwa uMajingila. But Kole, they would not say Mazingire, Engwakondlovu, Ngabalemba, but Majingila, we know. Douglas Mkhwananzi told me that. Kole Masuku, again, another Nguni chief who married Ufamona, Mtaka Lobengula. Kole, because, again, a Mkhwananzi woman was helped to conceive by a Kalanga gynecologist. And accordingly, instead this time of taking the name Khole, I mean of that doctor, who now I don't know because it was not documented through the naming process, but at least we know the type, Likhole, Likalanga, then the chief becomes Khole Masuku. Umtaka Mkhokhi was the chief of Inyama Indlovu.
How did people that we're living around him now, as he assumed this role of leader, how did they relate with her? How did they accept her guidance or her leadership?
Well, they did. And again, we need to point out the basis for that. When a king leaves, it's him who has the power. Others may have reflected power. We see a lot of these things. People thinking they are powerful when it's actually reflected power. But when the king dies, the wife becomes, the widow becomes very important. She still is regarded. Remember, when I have a wife, that wife, to my younger brothers and younger sisters, she is umnewetu, batibhuti. So she is a female bhuti, a male. But when I'm gone, her power, is because she is representing me in a way, especially before my son takes over. You find a lot of that among the Zulu, among the Swati. The mother of the heir apparent is powerful and becomes some kind of regent. So she was like that. In the absence of a king, being the senior queen meant she was. And a lot of chiefs were going to her. You will see Usivalu Mahlangu is sitting down and the queen is sitting in a chair. That picture to me is very important. It is telling a story about who was more important. I know a lot of lies are being peddled by people who don't understand our culture. If you don't know, people will make such weird and bizarre pronouncements out of ignorance, and they are not ashamed. Please learn to research, understand a people's culture, how it operated. If you did, you would never say that about women. You would never say that about Ndebele society. But some people just wake up and they think they know something about Ndebele and they make weird pronouncements. It's unfortunate. So chiefs were coming to consult. The princes, even abazukulu bakhe benkosi or Rhodes, bahamba baya kuye. U Rhodes came here, U Rhodes lo Albert. Those they still recognized her. She was wife of a king. She was a queen and was consulted. More so in this particular case, because kwaba le vacuum. The people who had have succeeded King Lobengula had left. It was Njube. He was no longer there. Which means Queen Lozikeyi continued the period of regency from 1893, when the king left, until her death 1919, because there was no one else who came in to represent the late king or to get into the shoes of the king. So she was a regent, almost a lifetime regent. And that explains her importance and being consulted, because she was a kind of queen mother and there was no heir until she died. And up to today, there has been no one to replace King Lobengula. So that makes her very special until she died. A queen mother, a regent queen, almost a career regent. That's what happened because Cecil Rhodes had decided, I don't want this Ndebele kingdom to be resuscitated again, and took away all those qualifying sons. And there were mischievous Ndebele people. We must point that one out. They knew. It's not Cecil John Rhodes who knew which sons qualified. They were pointed to him by the Ndebele who had become sellouts. But you do understand, they were fearful. I mean, these were people with guns and they had spears. And in any case, they downed their spears. But Rhodes still remained, him and his men, with guns. So they must have said, yes, that one qualifies. They knew the tradition and the succession rules. That one qualifies. That one also qualifies. So it meant there was no king, and that made her role all the more important and extended.
And then the whites, the Rhodes and them, how did they view Queen Lozikeyi?
They did. I mean, you can tell from, if you are driving out of Bulawayo, you are going, see, people think, oh, when you see Queen this, Queen that, Queen's this, is referring to Queen Victoria. It's not referring to Queen Victoria. It's referring to Queen Lozikeyi Lodlo. There's Queens, something, something, sports, something here in Bulawayo. Then there is Queen's Mine on the road to Tunkai, to Inyati. There's Queen's Mine just before you cross the Mbembezi River. That's Queen's Mine. So in other ways, it's the route to get to Nkosikazi. But Nkosikazi, to us, is Nkosikazi. But to them it's queen. To whites, in their language, it's queen. So, and they were visiting her. And we did make reference to Ukol and Brenda. He used to get there. That's why he took a picture. And there is a picture that you see. This Ukol and Brenda standing next. And a poise, your muntu, will tell you whether they are confident or not. When somebody comes and sit there in that sofa, you can tell whether they wield power and influence, confidence, by the manner in which they sit. You look at Queen Lozikeyi and how she stands there, you can see here is somebody who is wielding a lot of authority, and she was recognized as such. And remember, she had an area that was demarcated for her occupation. Nkosikazi. It was, and was extending. I've seen some people who have come to me to say, yeah, we used to be kings, we used to be chiefs here. They want to resuscitate it. Abakomasuku want to resuscitate it. Hlabangana also wants to resuscitate. So extending from the Mbembezi River right up almost to Lupani, they would claim it was her area and her people. And the general, and remember too, they paid these queens and they paid these chiefs. And Queen Lozikeyi was also paid. And when she died, a lot of her cattle were inherited by Sitambe, Princess Sitambe, because that was her daughter. Remember, we said she was a daughter of Mamfimfi, but Mamfimfi was coming as a surrogate wife as Inhlanzi for Lozikeyi. So technically, culturally, Sitambe was a daughter, not of Mamfimfi. Yes, mother biologically, but a daughter of Lozikeyi. That's why she got a lot of cattle. She inherited them and took them to where she was married, Kosiyacha Ufuyani. And important, and again, because she was a princess, she did not get into the village, Siyacha's village. No, she had her own village outside that one, and she was important and powerful. See, when we talk about these royal women, appreciate their power. Princess Sitambe carried a spear. Farm owner also had a spear, had a gun. And they are using it now when they are doing their rituals. They will use the bayonet, as I was told by Malagi Ndiwen when I interviewed him. And the story is there in one of my several books. So, and even their attire was different from other women. They would wear in Lugula. So that these were females. They were female, yes, but possessing the power of men. Zinkabi, who engineered the civil war in 1872, was a woman. And she was saying, I am not the heir apparent only because I'm a woman. Somebody younger than me is taking over. And that was Nkulumani. They were born of Mwaga, the two of them, with Zinkabi being the older of the two. But she could not succeed. Why? Because she's a woman. So he says, now, if power is eluding me, because she would have been powerful if her brother had become king. Masu, that will cause Kutuna. And this was a civil war.